Well, it took a long time for the rain to arrive in California, but it's finally here. I hope everything is great where you are. I was asked the question, the crucial question, how do you liberate your universe? That really is the crucial question. A little bit of background here before I get into that. I started studying the Course in Miracles in 1978 and stayed with it for 15 years of intense study, and then I continued on trying to assimilate and integrate everything that it said internally without having to read the words. So it's been a long association with the Course in Miracles. Maybe 34 years. And in the Course in Miracles, it explains what salvation really is. And to tell you the truth, no matter how much I studied it, I didn't quite understand that crucial part. I understood almost everything very clearly, but that crucial part, I just didn't get it. So don't be surprised if, even though you're very clear about a lot of different elements, that there may be one that you're not. It escapes your grasp somehow. Now, several days ago, several nights ago actually, I had a dream, and it clarified so much of what salvation really is. And I said, hey, that's what the Course in Miracles was saying all along. In order to receive something, you have to give it. That's what the Course kept saying. That's how reality actually works. I realized that everything that we think we're experiencing externally, we're really experiencing internally. And there's another facet to it. And fortunately, I have this facet very clear. Is that what is it that we're engaged in? This internal universe that we're carrying with us. We literally have our own universe we're carrying with us. We think it's out there, but it's in here, within perception, within awareness. What's taking place in all those people, all those actions and reactions and everything that's going on in your universe? What's really taking place is that everyone is working for you, working for a purpose. And as I've pointed out in my many videos, the purpose is actually to develop a power of negation. As Jesus said, existence is really an attempt to attack God. That is true. So your universe, everything is engaged in tremendous efforts to come up with some power of negation that can make you prime creator, can negate the true prime creator and make you spirit prime creator. Okay. So, your universe is actually a miserable universe because this is an impossible quest. And it's a miserable, it involves death and negation and destruction of all forms, which are only symbolic of reality. It's an all symbolic situation. But it's very, very stressful, miserable, difficult, and all of that. A lot of despair, a lot of feeling of futility. Thinking, how, you know, what is this life that I have? It's just so frustrating. I can't quite, you know, seem to really get what I really want, etc., etc. Okay. Now, we're moving right towards the crux of the whole situation. And I can use an analogy to point this out. Let us say you lived on an island, a beautiful island that had the perfect atmosphere and weather and climate. It was so balmy, you know, like a Hawaii to the nth degree. Soft, temperate breezes, perfume with flowers, and you just breathe it in and you just felt so refreshed. Everything was pure refreshment there. You felt perfectly well. It's just an incredible, miraculous island that you live on. Now let's say that you built this huge, vast research complex on this island of concrete, you know, rebar, concrete, threw some windows in there, but they're shuttered, heavy reinforced doors, just this massive campus of research and effort. And you've brought in all these researchers there. Hundreds of thousands are working in this vast complex. And they work in artificial light. The atmosphere in there is all controlled by the air conditioning. It's artificial atmosphere, artificial light. Okay. Everyone is in this complex. They stay there night and day. They're working round the clock. They're working so hard. They even have, you know, dormitories in there, cafeterias. And they're constantly working, and they never get to leave because they're slaving away for you. You want them to come up with the answer, how to negate reality, how to negate the Prime Creator. And you're afraid. You say you don't ever let them open the doors, open the windows, and let this atmosphere come in, the breeze of this incredibly beautiful island. The atmosphere there is perfect. You don't let it come in at all. You keep it all shuttered down. Why? Because you're afraid if anyone in there feels that atmosphere, they'll slack on their efforts and say, hey, wait a minute, what is this beautiful perfume breeze I'm feeling? Something feels so wonderful and refreshing. What is that? And what am I slaving away here at negation? I'm more interested in this breeze. I'm so attracted to it. So they'll slack off, and they'll start talking about others. Others will say, why are you slacking off? They say, feel this breeze, feel this atmosphere, it's fantastic. And they'll feel it too. And gradually everybody will start slacking off there. So you keep it in total lockdown situation. This is an analogy for our condition, our inner condition. We prevent the tremendously refreshing perfume of our of reality from entering into our research efforts, entering into our dream. We don't let any of the figures in our dream feel it at all. Okay? Now back to our analogy. Let us say that one day you realize that it's impossible to ever come up with any power of negation over reality. And no matter how much you slave drive all your researchers, no matter how brilliant they are, no matter how dedicated they are, they will never succeed. None of them will ever succeed. Doesn't matter what kind of managerial shifts you make, restructuring, organizational efficiency that you bring in, it will ultimately be completely futile. Therefore, it's futile right now, futile in the future, all futile. Therefore, you don't have to judge who's doing a better job than someone else. Because if it's all completely futile, that doesn't matter, does it? Doesn't matter if there's some slackers there. Doesn't matter who the hard workers are. Makes no difference. Because no matter what the situation is, the end result is total failure and futility. Zero success. So you say to yourself, you know what? I think instead of having these people slave away like that in this concrete bunker-like mentality, what I'm going to do, I'm going to set them all free from this task because it's a futile task. And I'm not happy sitting there seeing them slave away and suffer and die in so much misery. It doesn't make me happy at all. I'd like to see them all happy. So you say, okay, I know a way to accomplish this. And so you give the order, and you decree it, because you're the governor of this island. Your law is the word there. Okay. You say, I decree that all the doors and all the windows to this massive research complex be permanently opened. In fact, you're taking the doors off the hinges, removing the doors. You're removing the windows, okay? So you remove all the doors and all the windows. And you start cutting holes in the roof and the wall so they can't, you know, patch it up. And so you allow the atmosphere of this island to flood into this research complex. Gently. Not like a tsunami, but gently. It gently wafts into through this research building everywhere, down the corridors, into the cubicles, into the large control rooms, the research labs, every last part of it. Gradually, this atmosphere gently makes its way in there and mixes with the atmosphere already there and purifies it. Purify, purify, purify. And what happens is everybody sort of stops their effort and says, what is this? What is this miraculous breeze that is coming through this building? It seems so wonderful. I feel so wonderful. I don't feel like working on negation anymore. I feel rejuvenated. I feel fresh. I feel that I know life. I feel connected with spirit. And everybody stops their research efforts. And then gradually, somebody recognizes or sees, the door is open. They never thought such a thing was possible. There is no door there anymore. And they get to the door, they step across the threshold, and they walk outside a little bit and look around. They say, oh my gosh, it's so beautiful. The atmosphere out here is the same atmosphere we were feeling inside now. It's the same. It's all one atmosphere. And then they start walking down the beautiful trails. They go to the beach and the swaying palm trees, the beautiful emerald water. So wonderful. And they take a swim and they feel so refreshed. And they all eventually leave the bunker, the vast concrete bunker complex. And they're all now walking gently around the island and simply soaking in this tremendous vibrancy of peace and seamless oneness and refreshing atmosphere. And they completely forget about ever working for negation. They don't even remember working for negation. They have no desire or intention whatsoever to ever do that anymore again. And you, the Governor Island, look out and you see everybody on the island now. They're so incredible bliss. They're perfectly free. They feel totally free. And you see that. And that bliss, all you see is bliss. All you see is freedom. Everywhere you look, there's this tremendous joy and love and freedom. And they look at you and they say, oh, you're the governor of this island? Oh, that's so wonderful. What a great place it is. And there's joy everywhere. And you feel the joy. It comes back to you. How could you be sad when there's not a trace of sadness anywhere? How can you be tired when there's not a trace of tiredness anywhere? You've set everyone free in your dream, everyone in your universe, in your dream, you've set them free from the tasks that you before had demanded that they carry out for you. And so everyone in your dream is perfectly healthy, perfectly happy, perfectly free. And you think, wow, what a great thing I did. I feel everything that I've given, now I'm feeling it. You see, in return, I'm receiving it. Receiving it back. Okay, that's an analogy. That's what we do. Because every person we see, we're really seeing an image in our own mind of that person. And we're interacting, the interactions are with the images in our own mind, our perceptions, our judgments. We can set all those judgments and perceptions free. Why? By opening the doors that have been blocking the spirit, the true atmosphere of spirit, the true atmosphere of non-negation, okay, which is reality. Reality, there's no negation in reality. There's no getting old, there's no getting sick, there's no dying, there's nothing decaying, there's nothing falling apart, no negation at all. And that atmosphere of non-negation gently will move through the entirety of your inner landscape, which is populated by everything you've ever seen and ever experienced in existence. And everything will feel that. And we'll turn to that and say, ah, this is what I have always wanted. And everything in your inner landscape will be enlightened. And then you will look out upon this enlightened landscape and you will realize you too are enlightened. How could you not be? Because that's all you're seeing. So you will experience what the experience that you give others in your inner landscape. And how do you do this? You simply decide that you no longer want to pursue negation, the idea of negation, trying to find a way to negate God, the prime creator, so that you can be prime creator. And when you do that, the doors will open, the windows will open, and the inner landscape, the atmosphere, will be gently suffused with the ambience, the atmosphere of freedom. And then you will know your own freedom in that way. It's not possible for you to know your own true freedom if there's someone in your inner landscape that is not free. You have to extend freedom to all. See, it's an atmosphere. It comes in. There's no controlling it. It just automatically fills the entire space of your inner landscape with no judgment, no differentiation. It's like the sun shining on everything on this planet. Doesn't say, well, I'm going to shine on one and not on another. And again, you can decide to do this because you realize that all of those workers on your inner landscape, they were engaged in futility. And so there's no reason to continue judging of who's doing a better job than another or who deserves enlightenment more than another. They all deserve it. Doesn't matter, because none of them ever made any progress towards negation at all. Zero. So you all have to judge everything the same. It's all zero. So who is more or less worthy of enlightenment? They're all equally worthy. Either they're equally unworthy or equally worthy. Those are the only choice you have to make. And the choice you will make when you decide for non-negation is they're all equally worthy. And then the atmosphere will suffuse your inner landscape. And your universe is a free universe. Just like that. Now others? Now, what about in this world, as you're looking at others, they're getting sick, they're dying, etc. Not in your universe, they aren't. There's nothing dying in your universe. There's nobody getting sick in your universe. So, when people are getting sick here, they're getting sick in their universe, but not in yours. So everybody is eternally, perfectly free and well in your universe. That's all you see. That's all you feel, is this perfect wellness. I've always called that the Aloha wellness, you know. Like that, like it's beyond wellness. It's this wonderful, incredible feeling. Now, the people here are still dying, getting sick, dying, etc. That's happening in their universe because they're not setting everyone free in their universe. So they're still believing in negation. And so as they, some are still, you know, tasking, trying to, they're having some still work on negation in their universe. So that is what they're receiving. Part of them is still receiving that work on negation, which means they will get sick and they will die. You'll suffer, continue to suffer. And they'll continue to judge of who is working better than another and be very stressful. They won't have that perfect bliss. So in their universe, dying, they're still viewing dying. Dying is taking place. Death is still taking place. In your universe, it is not. Everyone has their own universe. And it's vital to understand that you do not control their universe. You don't control anyone else's universe. So they control it. Each one controls their own universe and decides for that. That is why you have had some come into this world and their universe, everyone was healthy, everyone was free, there was no death, etc. They come to this world. That is why they didn't cure all the problems of this world. They didn't. Because you are sovereign over your own universe. You decide whether that your universe is working on negation or you freed it and now you've given it non-negation. You freed it from that task. Each one has to decide. Nobody can force a decision on another. So you literally are the savior of your own universe. If that's the only place you're a savior, you're not a savior of someone else's universe. It's impossible. You cannot do that. Each aspect of spirit has perfect freedom to choose what they want to choose. Nobody can force a choice on them or overrule their choice. The most that anyone can do is showcase the example of they set their universe free from the task of negation, and what that's like, that people can at least recognize something like, there's something really here that is amazing, this perfect peace and tranquility and freshness, and people will say, this is really great, I like this, I want that, how do you get that? And they ask questions, and then they can be, you know, pointed in the right direction, but nobody can do the decision for anyone else. The decision remains with each one is sovereign over their own universe, and they have to decide, well, do I want to continue with the task of negation, this task of futility, really, or do I want to drop that? So, I've always maintained that the notions of a certain number of people in this world reaching quote-unquote enlightenment will automatically sweep everybody else into enlightenment. Well, there's two ways of looking at that. It may be that the presence of enough beings who have chosen to drop the task of negation may have a profound effect on others who will say, you know what? This is what I want, and I feel like it's the right thing, so I'm going to make my choice. But you cannot force the situation. So it's not automatic that, you know, the 100th monkey thing is not automatic in this situation at all. Because there may be many who decide, you know, I want to continue on with my universe the way it is and all this work on negation because I believe I can find an answer. So I'm going to do that. For me, that's more likely, just looking at the situation. I see many aspects of spirit in this world who are very dedicated to the idea of negation still, very, very dedicated to it, and they believe that they have a way to do it. They can get the computational power up high enough, they think that this is going to work for them. A lot of people were on the fence thinking, which way do I go? And then all this computational power was developed in this world. And that caused a really tremendous falling away from many who were on the fence. They decided, you know what? I think this computational power is really going to help me a lot in negation, so I'm going to continue on with that. It's a very difficult time, the last 50 years, while computational power was coming into its own on this planet. Very seductive. Because the precision, the speed, the complexity, the power of all of that has been increasing exponentially. And we're thinking, wow, you know, I might be able to really control my universe to an unprecedented extent. I might be able to get everybody really working much, much more effectively than before on negation. Therefore, it seems like I really hate to pull the plug on that effort right now. That's the feeling I think many, many have in this world. They want enlightenment, but they're also saying, well, you know, maybe it's premature to pull the plug because there's so many options and opening up. That seems like I might be able to, you know, develop a lot of different ways to treat illnesses and might be able to develop a lot of ways for group interaction, and I might be able to arrange my universe in new and different ways and approach situations from more innovative angles and get more done, etc., etc., etc. So we've been dragged down this road now for quite some time here. It's been very difficult. Very fortunate the Course in Miracles came out prior to all of this. and for me that I was able to gain tremendous traction with that prior to the computational situation rolling out in here in this world, which I saw firsthand living in Silicon Valley. It was really a very frightening thing, actually, because I could see where it's going. I say, you know, this is like going in the opposite direction that the Course in Miracles is advising us. It's like the counterpart, the opposition is here now. So the Course in Miracles knew that this was coming into the world, that the computational power would be rolled out here. I was very well aware of that, and therefore it was made available prior to this happening. So those who had wanted to steal a march on it could do so. And in doing so, I was somehow able to survive it to the point where I can speak like I'm speaking now. But doesn't seem like there's not many in the world who, you know, are speaking up at this point. I know it used to be a lot more, but it's now very hedged, okay? The speech in this world is very much hedged in a certain way. You can tell that like people are saying, well, you know, I don't know if I really want to go all in. You know, it seems like the future is very tantalizing. Like maybe we can cure cancer. Maybe we can get rid of some things, you know, on and on and on. And also people are intimidated, very intimidated. I say people have shifted into appeasement mode, okay? Trying to appease the rulers of the future. Those who have masters of computational power. They want to appease them and act as if they're all for the whole thing, going along with the program, you know? Whereas inside, they really don't want to. It's the Stockholm Syndrome where you get kidnapped and you end up, you know, accepting the ideology of your kidnappers to appease them. For those who remember, that's the Patty Hearst Syndrome of the Symbionese Liberation Army, where she was kidnapped and she then ended up robbing banks and doing all this stuff that you wouldn't expect her to do because she was so desperate to stay alive. She wanted to appease her kidnappers. I say that on a much larger scale. We are so desperate to survive in this world that so many are trying to appease these computational wizards here and pretend that they're all in on this, even though they really are not at all. So I'm saying to all of you that it is possible to completely rebuff this direction of the computational power and say, no, I'm through with the working on negation. My universe, I'm going to liberate it. I'm going to set it free. You do what you want to, okay? But those who do not are really being, what has to be said, is being foolish. Doesn't matter how great they are in computational power. They're still being completely foolish because they're continuing to pursue an impossible objective. Reality cannot be negated. Totally impossible. I had the advantage of having seen this, experienced it. I know it's true, because I saw reality and there was zero negation there, not even the tiniest bit. And I received complete assurance that it's impossible, can never be negated. I believe that without a shadow of a doubt. So I know that those who are continuing to pursue negation are pursuing a foolish quest. I'm not impressed by the computational wizards at all. The big honchos, the head honchos of this planet now, I'm not impressed by them one bit. So I'm not trying to appease them. So I'm speaking out very directly here, saying things that you're not hearing anywhere else, because there's a lot of appeasement everywhere else. And you can hear that storm right here. Well, there's a storm coming in this world right now, I tell you that. So I would like for each one of you that is listening to this to take heart, access how what your true feeling, ask yourself, do you want to set your universe free? Do you want to be the liberator of your universe? Do you want to do it now? Because now is a great time to do it. I will continue to give you support, encourage you to do this, and give you the flavor of non-appeasement. Give you the flavor of total assurance. And thereby steady your conviction that you can do it too. Someday you will liberate your universe for sure. But why wait? Because all those workers are slaving away in that bunker complex research laboratory trying to find negation, and you're the one that is holding them there. Literally. And it's within your power to set them free. Take the doors off the hinges. Take the windows out. Let the air in. Let the air of freedom in. Don't be intimidated by the heavyweights of this world, the computational heavyweights, who believe that they're going to have it all their way. They can't tell you how to run your universe, just like you can't tell them how to run theirs. If you want to set your universe free, you can do it. So do it now.